all those monsters on one plane.
Foxtrot Charlie, we are ready to disembark.
Hope this goes smoothly.
Close forward gate.
This is a well-oiled machine. The only thing we gotta worry about is stale peanuts and a little turbulence.
Go!
From Touchstone Pictures and producer Jerry Bruckheimer comes a film that will change the way you feel about the friendly skies.
Jailbird 1, you are not cleared for takeoff.
And nobody on this aircraft gives a flying.
Nicolas Cage, John Malkovich, John Cusack, Ving Rhames, Steve Buscemi, and Rachel Ticketing are just a few of the faces you'll see as we take an insider's look at what happens when good and evil collide at 20,000 feet.
We're going to try to give you, a good hour and a half of some real excitement.
U.S. Marshals Service annually flies 155,000 prisoners around the country for transfers, legal hearings, and medical exams. As you know, today's flight is a special one.
We're populating Alabama's Felton Penitentiary.
Now, most of these guys are lifers, some on death row. Pure predators, each and every one of them.
Cyrus Grissom, also known as Cyrus the Virus. Kidnapper, robber, murderer. Nathan Jones, a.k.a. Diamond Dog, former general of the Black Gorillas. Garland Green, the Marietta Mangler, serial killer. And Cameron Poe, a parolee, just trying to hitch a ride home.
Cameron Poe is, unfortunately, a besmirched hero. He's a U.S. Army Ranger, fought to defend his country. He got in a fight to protect his wife. And unfortunately, somebody died.
He's a sort of simple, honest, working class hero who ends up, at the bottom of the social pile in prison.
It is the order of this court that you be remanded to a federal penitentiary where you shall remain incarcerated for a term not less than 7 to 10 years.
What motivated me to play Cameron Poe was the notion of the rehabilitated prisoner on parole going home to see his family.
He was carrying his child at the time, And he's sent away for 8 years and he hasn't seen Casey at all except through pictures and letters.
He's released, he's done his time, and all he wants to do is be reunited with his family.
I'm going home, son!
Unfortunately, instead of taking the bus, you got on the plane. It was a wrong plane.
Give me a taser!
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your captain speaking. I have the only gun on board. Welcome to Con Air.
When we return, take a ride with America's worst criminals without ever leaving a Hollywood soundstage. John Malkovich plays Cyrus the Virus Grissom, a criminal who uses his superior intelligence to execute the most daring mid-air hijacking ever attempted.
It is an interesting concept to think what would happen if a super criminal took over the plane and had a plan.
Gentlemen, in roughly 5 hours, we will be flying over the shores of Mexico, but first we have to change aircraft.
Thank you, and have a pleasant flight.
I mean, it doesn't hurt in any field to be intelligent, certainly not the field of being a criminal.
Pilot wants to know what's next.
He's to land at Carson City Airport as scheduled.
Carson City? The law's down there. You lost your mind?
According to my last psych evaluation, yes.
You only dream that you can get John Malkovich to play your villain.
Action!
John is always different in every movie, and he has a way of creating a very interesting character.
Oh, stewardess, what's the in-flight movie today?
Well, I think you'll like it, Cyrus. It's called I'll Never Make Love to a Woman on the Beach Again. And it's preceded by the award-winning short, No More Steak for Me Ever.
While the atmosphere on the jailbird may seem rugged, these conditions are actually the product of a healthy dose of imagination.
We're in a C-123. It's an old Air Force cargo transport airplane that we've modified with a few things to work as the jailbird for Conair.
It's real Conair. It's hubbed out of Oklahoma City. Marshall Service runs it. It actually doesn't look like this. It's a commercial airline. But we just did this is much more spectacular to make this look like a prison and the cages and, you know, just heightens it.
What you looking at, punk?
Nothing. I was just admiring your cage.
For the highly technical interior sequences, the filmmakers simulated flight conditions on a Hollywood soundstage.
Well, this is our mock-up of the plane. It's all mounted on air-driven gimbals, which make the whole plane rock and shake and throw all the actors around.
Rolling!
189 Hotel, take four.
Quiet, please.
And action.
Roll this to him. This one made it nuts.
This state-of-the-art equipment took 10 weeks to build and weighed in at over 40,000 pounds.
The plane actually does whatever a plane would do, including crashing.
Three, two, one, crash!
Having transformed an ordinary airplane into a virtual prison with wings, the filmmakers now turned their attention to filling it with an assortment of menacing criminals.
Kind of just raided the acting world for the freshest, strangest, most interesting type of actors around.
My, as I look around, I see a lot of celebrities among us. I see 11 current affairs, 2 hard copies, and a genuine Geraldo interviewee.
Play a character named Diamond Dog. He's on death row. He looks at Cyrus as a way out and his last choice outside of prison.
What do you want to do with him?
I don't know, but this is no way to treat a national treasure. Let him out.
You sure?
Love your work.
I play a character named Garland Green. I guess you could say he makes a career out of murdering people for fun.
They say the way he killed those people makes the Manson family look like the Partridge family. Well, he's on the right flight.
All the rest of the cast are either, you know, boxers or ex-cons who were boxers or hockey enforcers. I mean, it's quite a fun group.
We call them the 27 Yankees of murderers and psychopaths. And then right in the middle, you stick Nick Cage.
So what was that all about?
Oh, nothing. Except they somehow managed to get every creep and freak in the universe onto this one plane, and then somehow managed to let them take it over.
Poe, our hero, is stuck in the middle of this man's, you know, dastardly plot.
Hey, Chief.
What is it?
This looks like the drawing of a plane.
Who showed us that? The virus.
Another man with a vested interest in Cyrus's plans is U.S. Marshal Vince Larkin.
Firm, fair, and vigilant.
He's the guy who, like, doesn't want everything to blow up and doesn't want everybody to die. Where are you going with my plane, Cyrus?
We're going to Disneyland.
He was this guy who's just having a really bad day.
I mean, nothing fazes the guy.
It seems that your husband, Cameron, had an opportunity to get off the plane and he didn't do it. And I was hoping you could maybe help me figure out why?
I'm pretty mad at first. You know, thinking, why is he staying on there to defend these people?
I want to stay on.
What?
Changed my mind. I don't think he could be the best family man knowing that he bailed on his cellmate.
Baby-O's not a bad guy, but he's a tough guy. You know, he'll definitely let you have it, especially if you mess with his buddy, Poe.
Wait, it was me!
Me. We would do anything to keep each other alive.
And there's the honor of Bishop as well, which is that she's this very appealing woman.
Hey, lady,
Lady's a dog in a Walt Disney movie. My name is Bishop. Guard Bishop to you.
She is one of the reasons why Nicolas Cage's character decides to stay on this plane.
Poe, think of your little girl.
Now, what would my daughter think of me if I left you like this to get disarmed and die?
Then I'd start to read his files and find out his background.
U.S. Ranger, highly decorated. Did a little hell-raising when he was a kid, but nothing serious.
Explain to me why any of this matters.
You do the math on this, and we got an ally on that plane.
When we return, see how the filmmakers staged a pivotal battle sequence in a deserted stretch of the Utah desert. Blockbusters such as The Rock and Crimson Tide, producer Jerry Bruckheimer and his partner, the late Don Simpson, have assembled a remarkable track record of success. Now with Con Air, Bruckheimer tackles the open skies with an all-star cast, a high-octane script, and a few surprises.
What I try to do with the films I make is try to make it about the characters.
I like that he seems to genuinely care about the balance between action and character development. In that regard, I think Con Air is very Jerry.
It takes a guy with the genius of Jerry Bruckheimer to give a guy like Simon West a shot at a big film like this.
I knew he had the chops to go the long distance, the long schedule.
I think he did a terrific job.
And action!
He just sees things in his head differently.
Some of West's greatest challenges as a director involved Cyrus's surprise landing at Lunar Airfield.
The plan is they'll be met by a second plane at one of these stops and go off to a country that doesn't have an extradition policy with America.
We've gotten away with it. The beautiful thing about it is that we kind of become a team, and then I kind of betray the team.
That's my plane!
And things go awry and all hell breaks loose.
Looks like you missed your connection.
Sai.
Anara.
For these action-packed ground sequences, the filmmakers chose a location that would be both visual and unique.
These guys have been locked up for 10, 20, 30 years, some of them, in small little boxes. And I wanted to go somewhere that was the complete opposite. When there was a location I chose because it looked like the surface of the moon, 110 in the shade, and we were doing very physical work.
And on action, they start firing.
If it all comes to a head here, we've got about 50 National Guards, and we've got about 23 cons that are having a major shootout. What we did was we went in and developed a giant stage.
This is the boneyard. This is the hangar.
What's that?
That's a rock.
We took the gauntlet, and we laid out the closing of the front door and the closing of the back door to give ourselves a stage all in between where we could shoot.
Because of the intense nature of the sequence, the filmmakers relied heavily on pyrotechnics for a realistic effect. To protect the cast and crew, each explosion was choreographed with unyielding precision.
Bam, 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 you better get the hell out of there now. Boom, boom, boom. Now the back goes wham, 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 wham.
I like the things that are one take. In some ways, because you know you can't do it again, and so you put up as many cameras as you can. I think we've, you know, ended up with some great images.
Now.
I have to say that whether I wanted to or not, I did most of my own stunts in this movie. There were explosions, you know, 5 feet behind me, flaming helicopters dropping right behind me, ball bearing bullets over my head. So there was a level of intensity, fear, you might say, sure.
One of the more remarkable stunts filmed at Wendover involved a jailbird as it makes its getaway with a very unusual accessory.
It's a 67 Corvette, beautiful metallic blue. My pride and joy.
For decades, action movies have featured some spectacular car crashes, but Con Air is about to top them all.
It's a pretty stunning stunt, actually. I don't ever remember seeing a plane actually take off with a car hooked on it, certainly not with a cherry bed on it.
Ah!
On any other day, that might seem strange.
Isn't that your car?
As the escape continues, tension mounts between Marshal Larkin and DEA agent Duncan Malloy.
There's sort of a jurisdictional battle, like who's gonna be in charge of taking the plane down. Is it the Marshals or the DEA? So he and I butt heads.
Who are you to decide the value of a man's life? There are innocent people up there.
About time.
For what? About time for what?
Attack choppers. We're going after them.
With a crippled plane and several choppers airborne simultaneously, the filmmakers turn to a crack aerial photography unit in order to capture the chase.
Being a big action film like this, it's up to us to try and put this sequence together so there's a lot happening real fast with all the aircraft. When we're in the air, we don't have the liberty of making it up as we go. You pretty well got to know going in what you're coming for.
After meticulous planning and rehearsal, the aerial team was ready to take to the skies, equipped with some space-age technology.
Well, this is a space cam system. It's a gyro-stabilized, remotely controlled system that allows mounting of various cameras. With this type of flying in these canyons, this aircraft is particularly suitable.
Fire!
It may seem that no challenge was too great for this production. The greatest one of all was yet to come.
Put this thing down.
Strip's where I'm gonna land.
Only the word is crash.
When we return, our convicts head for a night out on the Las Vegas Strip. Convincingly crash land an airplane on the Las Vegas Strip, the filmmakers turn to DreamQuest Images for some movie magic.
They did as much as they could with real planes and real crashes, but there's a certain level of action that they simply couldn't do for real, and that's where we came in.
DreamQuest's first order of business was to arrange a collision between the crashing Jailbird and a famous Las Vegas landmark.
The model shop crew, under the direction of Michael Stewart, worked with blueprints from the real sign and duplicated it down to the finest detail.
What we have here is the fifth scale Hard Rock Hotel guitar. This sign in its entirety is about 18 feet tall.
We also had the large scale plane model hung from wires, two cranes situated 500 feet apart with cable running in between them, and the plane would fly down that cable.
Once the plane is moving, we cannot stop it.
To further complicate all of this, we were matching location photography that was done at the Hard Rock Hotel in Las Vegas.
It was wonderful to see this thing get wrecked.
Wounded but still airborne, the Jailbird is ready to make a spectacular landing on Las Vegas Boulevard.
We had to come in and figure out a way to make this crash happen. In order to do that, we built about 250 feet of the Vegas Strip. In miniature, we set up the background street with the plane, towed the plane down the street, crashing into things, breaking lampposts, cars were hitting the plane, bouncing off, exploding in flames.
Well, viva Las Vegas.
The other type of scene that we did was a digital compositing scene. This is where we shot a background plate on the Vegas Strip with real cars, real people, the real strip. Took all those elements, the plane, light passes on the plane, computer-generated smoke for the plane, loaded those all in the computer, and then layered them together.
With the Jailbirds getting to a stop on the Strip, it would seem that we have finally reached the end of the line. But no Jerry Bruckheimer production would be complete without one last grand surprise.
I think it's something we got very lucky that the Sands was gonna be demolished very shortly, and we're just helping them along.
We've actually got a full-size plane crashing into the Sands Casino, and I didn't wanna do that last scene as a miniature because I wanted people involved.
Everyone's gotta be on their toes.
This thing's coming in angry, it will eat you.
It's a one-take deal, and that's why we have so many cameras.
Roll, cameras, please!
And action!
Hey,
everything to give the audience a real big bang.
Fire in the hole!
Boys with guns. What can go wrong?
This is like a modern day Western. And Nick Cage is playing John Wayne.
Let's do it!
It's like how we'd all want to behave if we were in that situation.
Freeze, little bitch boy!
They say you can measure the greatness of people by how they act under pressure.
I'm gonna show you God does exist.
However many tricky shots I dream up, in the end, you have to rely on having great scenes between these people.
It's a great thrill ride.
Ceasefire! That is my plane!
What would you do if you're strapped in a plane with a bunch of these insane convicts?
What do you think I'm going to do? I'm going to save the day.
Hey, Paul. Next time, take the bus.